Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. Have you ever flown into an emotional rage over a meaningless comment by a friend, or found yourself sobbing at a sappy commercial on TV? Or maybe you were so stressed about an upcoming event that you snapped at your younger sibling for, well, existing? If so, someone might have commented that you seemed a little hormonal. And especially at your age, hormones can certainly play a big part in how we feel and react. But hormones do much more in our bodies than just controlling our mood swings. We literally couldn't survive without them. Today, we'll look at the endocrine system, which controls the production of these hormones. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain the role of hormones, list the major glands of the endocrine system, and give examples of hormones produced by the endocrine system. So, you've probably heard a lot about hormones, but what exactly are they? Well, they are simply chemicals. Chemicals that are released by various cells and glands in your body that broadcast messages. What other body system have you learned about that sends messages? The nervous system. The difference is that the nervous system sends direct messages to individual cells. It's like texting a message to your friends, one at a time. If instead you wanted to get a message out to everyone you know, all at once, you might post something on social media, or go really big and put an ad on TV. The endocrine system is like putting the ad on TV. It can broadcast chemical messages to large numbers of cells, all at once, instead of communicating with individual cells directly. But we know that TV ads don't reach every single viewer. They are usually targeted to a specific audience. The analogy works here with hormones as well, as the chemical message isn't necessarily received by all 100 trillion cells in your body. Most hormones have target cells that they intend to chemically communicate with. These target cells have a receptor that will attach to the specific hormone, instigating the action that the hormone stimulates. A single hormone may interact with millions of target cells to accomplish its task. So, what is the task of all these hormones, if not to turn us into raging emotional fools? Well, the roles of hormones are widespread. Some control metabolic functions, such as the regulation of glucose and water content in our blood, or immune responses such as inflammation. Others control reproductive functions in our bodies, and some determine our physiological and mental reactions to stimuli at given times. There are two classes of hormones, steroidal and non-steroidal. You may be used to thinking of steroids as controlled and possibly illegal substances used by some athletes. But chemically, a steroid is any organic molecule with a certain shape, generally having four ring structures like this molecule. Any idea what we are looking at here? It's cholesterol, which is a type of steroid. Steroidal hormones are produced from cholesterol, the molecule you just saw, so they are lipids and can cross cell membranes easily. Remember learning about selective permeability of the membrane in our cell unit? It does come in handy here, as these molecules blend right in with the lipid bilayer, allowing them direct access to the contents of the cell. Once inside the cell, they can bind directly to the DNA in the nucleus and initiate transcription of specific genes into mRNA, causing the desired proteins to be produced by the ribosome. Because of this ability, steroid hormones often function as gene regulators, turning on and off certain genes, or sets of genes. This can have dramatic effects on the cell, and even the functioning of our entire body. Non-steroidal hormones are proteins and amino acids. These molecules are not able to pass through the cell membrane, so they can only bind to receptors on the outside. But this binding activates enzymes on the inside that can carry out whatever job is needed by the hormone. From your lesson on human body systems, you know that the endocrine system communicates with the body by sending chemical signals. And we now know that these chemical signals are sent as hormones. But where do these hormones come from? The endocrine system consists of many glands that produce, store, and secrete the hormones directly into the bloodstream. How do the glands know when to release hormones and when to stop? Most of these glands are controlled by feedback loops. We've seen several examples of feedback loops in biology already, and these will work the same way. If too much of a hormone is detected by the body, this stimulates the gland to produce less. Once the hormone levels drop too low, this stimulates the gland to produce more. There are many different endocrine glands all over your body that produce hormones. The pineal gland produces serotonin, the hormone responsible for many of those mood swings we talked about earlier. The thyroid produces hormones that regulate metabolism. In the pancreas, an important hormone that regulates blood sugar is made. Much of your growth and development is controlled by hormones released by the hypothalamus and pituitary. We briefly mentioned the thymus in the previous lesson, as it releases hormones that work with the immune system to produce T cells and B cells. The adrenal gland makes hormones that help our body respond to stress. The ovaries and testes produce the hormones estrogen or testosterone, which regulate reproductive capabilities, as well as control developmental processes in males and females. Let's take a closer look at a few of these glands and see how the hormones they produce help our body function. Your thyroid is located at the base of your neck and produces thyroxine, a hormone that regulates the rate of metabolism and cellular respiration. If too much thyroxine is produced, it causes a condition known as hyperthyroidism. This can cause nervousness and a high body temperature and blood pressure. Conversely, hypothyroidism results from too little thyroxine and will result in a lower body temperature, low energy levels, and unexplained weight gain. Our body's ability to maintain homeostasis depends on having just the right amount of each hormone. In the pancreas, insulin and glucagon are produced. You've learned about insulin before. Remember that it is responsible for stimulating cells to take glucose out of the blood. When this hormone is absent or not functioning properly, diabetes can occur. Luckily, you may remember from our lesson on DNA technology that insulin can be produced through cloning and given to patients who are unable to produce enough on their own. The hypothalamus and pituitary glands are found at the base of the skull and work together to produce hormones that often control the functions of other organs. A hormone we've seen a few times already, ADH, is produced here. Remember that this is the hormone responsible for controlling the water content in your blood and has a large effect on the excretory system's ability to filter toxins. Other hormones produced here regulate processes in the reproductive system, such as FSH, which stimulates the production of eggs and sperm cells. The pituitary usually makes the hormones and the hypothalamus control when and where they are released.
Ah! What was that?
Yikes, my heart is racing. That just gave me a huge rush of adrenaline. Adrenaline, also known as epinephrine, is a hormone released by the adrenal gland when stimulated by a nerve impulse indicating stress. And that loud boom definitely caused a little stress for me. Adrenaline will very quickly elevate your heart rate, blood flow, and blood glucose levels. This is actually an adaptation by our body because the assumption is that we may have an immediate need to engage in intense physical activity, like running away from an explosion. Fortunately, it looks like we're safe here, so there's no need. But my body was getting me ready, just in case. This is sometimes called the fight or flight response. Either case would require a quick dose of energy. In addition to making us shaky after a big event, adrenaline or epinephrine can also be given as an injection to reverse the effects of a severe allergic reaction. People with life-threatening allergies often carry a pen-like injectable containing epinephrine at all times in case of accidental exposure. Remember those rage fits we mentioned before? One disadvantage of adrenaline is that it can make us feel angry or agitated. After all, it just prepared your body for something intense. And if the energy isn't needed for battle or fighting off a bear or some other threat, it has to go somewhere. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how hormones can send chemical messages throughout our bodies. These messages stimulate cells to perform certain tasks and release other chemicals that keep our bodies functioning all day and night. Next time, we'll take a look at how humans grow and develop, starting from just a tiny single cell in the womb. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. See you next time. Hey, hey.